in Graham's antiphon. I will look after my sheep, says the Lord, and I will appoint a shepherd to pasture them, and I, the Lord, will be their God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
We call to mind our sins, especially in relation to today's God's Word, today's first reading, and the responsorial psalm we're in. As children of God, He expects us, or God invites us, to be light in the darkness of our world. And in the light of today's gospel, to renounce everything and everyone as disciples of the Lord, blocking us in becoming one, or more and more one in His Spirit, and sent or as sent for His mission. The problem with this, of course, is that we have to constantly check ourselves in ways, day after day, whether we are really light, God's light, in the darkness of our world. Also, whether we are really disciples, meaning as faith truly matters, whether we are really engaging in the process to become more and more holy, blocking again or getting rid of everything and everyone, blocking us in the way of becoming one in the Spirit of Jesus. All this are to be conscious, deliberate, and intentional. In all the times and ways when we failed to respond to God's invitation to be light in the darkness of our world, and to be truly holy and sent for His mission, we say, I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned
in
what I have done, what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Today we celebrate the feast of St. Charles Borromeo, Bishop, a model as Bishop and our pastor in ways of bringing the people of God to truly become disciples of the Lord, holy and engaging in the mission of Jesus. Let us pray. Preserve in the midst of your people, we ask, O Lord, the spirit with which you filled the Bishop St. Charles Borromeo, that your church may be constantly renewed, and by conforming herself to the likeness of Christ, may show His face to the world, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
everything without grumbling or questioning, that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God without blemish, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine like lights in the world, as you hold on to the word of life, so that my boast for the day of Christ may be that I did not run in vain or labor in vain. But even if I am poured out as a libation upon the sacrificial service of your faith, I rejoice and share my joy with all of you. In the same way, you also should rejoice and share your joy with me. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The response to that psalm, the Lord is my light and my salvation.
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom should I fear? The Lord is my life's refuge. Of whom should I be afraid?
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
One thing I ask of the Lord, this I seek, to dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, that I may gaze on the loveliness of the Lord and contemplate his temple.
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
I believe that I shall see the bounty of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord with courage. Be stout-hearted and wait for the Lord.
The Lord is my light.
When St. Paul brought early Christianity, really early Christianity, to the pagan world around him, he was bringing this faith into a hostile environment. It was multi-religious. There were many different mouths, but they cannot speak. They have noses, but they cannot smell. They're just a piece of rock. There's only one God. There's only one Lord. And you can imagine how well that was received by the pagan world around him at that time. Yesterday, we heard one of the greatest proclamations from Paul. There's a controversy among scripture scholars about where this particular passage came from. Some think it was a song of the early church that they just kind of plugged into the letter of Paul. But be that as it may, we give him the credit for it. And you heard it proclaimed. At the name of Jesus, every knee must bend. In the heavens, on the earth, and under the earth, every tongue proclaim, Jesus Christ is Lord. Now that pagan world 2,000 years ago would have been all right with Christianity if Paul had proclaimed Jesus Christ is a Lord, small L, along with the other lords that paganism proclaimed. That's not what the proclamation is. Jesus Christ is Lord. Capital L. His name is above every other name. And throughout 2,000 years of Christianity, there have been those who have opposed that. Now I mention that because periodically through the history of the church, there have been times of great trouble. So some of the greatest of the early saints were raised up by God during a time of intense persecution. They were being killed, burned, beheaded, executed, tortured to death, eaten by animals, etc. during a time of persecution. And in those times, God revealed his knack for raising up people to protect the church, but also to help the church bear up during those troubled times. Today's saint, 1,500 years later, is a classic example of that. Charles Borromeo was made a cardinal by his uncle, Pope, at the age of 22. Can you imagine that? 22 years old, and all of a sudden he's a cardinal. But he was trained in the law. He became a great champion of the church during an extremely troubled time. His adulthood was in the early stage of the Protestant Reformation, when the Reformation reformers, a very kind of person you could imagine, were spreading like wildfire through Europe. People were leaving the church in droves. And God raised up, among others, this saint, this cardinal, who became a great pastor, a model pastor, according to the church at the time, a great teacher, a great defender of the church, who in his diocese applied many of the reforms of the Council of Trent. Now there are some of us who might remember the church that the Council of Trent put in place. It was the church we grew up in. At least I did, well, some of you did. And the Council of Trent's reforms, responding to the claims of the Reformation people, guided the church through that time. And when Charles Borromeo died, something like 1584 or thereabouts, it was right at the beginning of the era of religious wars, one of the most horrible times in the history of the church. The very thing that Luther was warned about. Lordship of Jesus. Is it easy? No. But it's the key to effective discipleship. So Charles Borromeo is a classic example of God raising up various people to continue proclaiming the message. And he has raised you up to continue proclaiming the message. As you heard, in this parish, we are launching a parents teaching their kids their faith at home with this pandemic. I approve of that. I support that. But as I shared with our ministry team, I find it really ironic. We were doing that 30 years ago, 40 years ago, when I lived in Minnesota as a religious education coordinator. We called it family-centered education. And I remember hearing 40 years ago, the average Catholic sitting there in the pews, not you, of course, the average parent sitting there in the pews believes he or she is totally inadequate when it comes to sharing their faith with their kids. That's going to be the big hurdle in what we're launching today. And parents teaching their kids, they don't feel equipped. That's what we have Father for. That's what we have Deacon Bill for, or Deacon Scott for, or Deacon Mike for, or Sister for. But I, not me, I can't do that. Well, you can, if you're a parent, because God has raised you up for this troubled time to proclaim to your kids, to proclaim to the world around you, that Jesus Christ is Lord. God bless you.
Successor of the apostles. That each day they become spirit-filled and spirit-led, bringing the people of God to the holiness of Jesus the Christ in engaging in the mission of Jesus. For this we pray to the Lord. We pray for our priests and deacons and religious men and women, lay faithful, engaging whatever form ministry in the church, that they will respond to God's call to be one in His Spirit, to be truly a disciple, meaning to be truly holy, becoming a saint. Engaging in the same mission of Christ. For this we pray to the Lord. We pray for the healing of our world, for the healing of broken relations between nations and groups and communities or families, that this healing will bring people the healing of their spirit, of their soul, to Christ. For this we pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
In particular, we pray for the sick, for the victims of this pandemic, and all those in whatever form of illness or ailment. And again, their pains and sufferings, the trials and difficulties will bring them one in the redemptive suffering of Jesus on the cross. For this we pray to the Lord.
Lord,
we pray for the faithful departed, for all the deceased, For those who have nobody, and I pray for them, but who need most, of God's mercy, our prayers, that they will have God's eternal peace. For this we pray to the Lord. For the gift of prayer and repentance and conversion, that people will come back home to God and discover the Lord who is seeking each one in the great encounter of our religious experience, wherein with God's grace, each one can say, or will say, no turning back. For this we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
All these, Heavenly Father, we ask through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for to you goodness we have received. The bread we offer you, fruit of the earth, and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God. By the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share with the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may become acceptable to God, the Almighty. Look, Lord, upon the offering placed on your altar in commemoration of St. Charles, and grant by the power of this sacrifice that as you made him an attentive pastor, outstanding in the merit of his virtues, so you may make us abound in good fruit by our works, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It
is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For us on the festival of St. Charles Borromeo, you bid your church rejoice. So too you strengthen her by the example of his holy life. Teach her by his words a preaching, and keep her safe in answer to his prayers. And so with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim.
Holy.
Indeed, holy Lord, the fount of therefore these gifts we pray by sending down your Spirit upon them like a dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and, once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity. Together with Francis, our Pope, and Myron, our Bishop, and all the clergy, remember also brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all those who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, her blessed spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
At our Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant our peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom of God, the
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to the apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Lamb of God, behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Thank you. It was not you who chose me, says the Lord, but I who chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. Please be seated. Let us pray. May the sacred mysteries of which we have partaken, O Lord, we pray, give us the determination which made Saint Charles faithful in ministry and fervent in charity to Christ our Lord. Today is Wednesday, and we continue with our faith permission in Eucharistic spirituality. And we know it, the Eucharist, the source and the summit of the Christian life. This is our fifth session on Wednesday. Everyone is welcome. We have three seasons, fall and winter and spring, and we are only starting. We had our first topic, what do you seek? A second one, who are you? The third one, why a God? The fourth one, what's our story? And today's topic, the venue will be here, by the way, in the church. Time from 6 to 7 in the evening. This topic is, who is Jesus? The church has been asking that question for the last 2,000 years. And we have to ask ourselves, that's right, who is Jesus in my life? And where I am. So that's our topic this evening. Everybody is welcome. If you have time, please come. Nobody is late in this course. We still have 2B great seasons to move forward with God's grace. We can never tell, but at least as planned, we still have winter, and we are not yet in winter, and we have springtime. So again, Eucharistic spirituality. What is that? And should our life not be engaging in Eucharistic spirituality? The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may the Almighty God bless you all. The Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit come down upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen. Our Eucharistic celebration is ended. So let us go forth now with love and joy to serve the Lord.